So in the last class, we discussed about different identifiers. Particularly for the time being, we focused on variables, which will be needed for writing all type of Python programs that we'll be writing. We also very briefly discussed about functions and classes. They will be discussed in details later on. So identifiers, as you can remember, identifiers are just the names given to the variables, functions, and classes. So basically, the Python programmers would be responsible to name those identifiers. That is to name those variables, functions, and classes. There are certain rules or restrictions regarding how we will be able to how we will be able to name one identifier, such as variables, functions, or classes. First and foremost rule is the identifier name should be consisting of lowercase letter, uppercase letter, digits, and underscore. That is, these are some valid identifiers. Name, all small, NAME. Age, all capital, or say tax underscore rate underscore 2020. So these are some of the valid identifier names. Now you might be wondering, what are they? This can be a variable, this can be a function, this can be a class as well. Depending on your context or depending on what value you are putting into it will be specified whether it is a variable, function, or class. The second rule is identifiers are case sensitive. That is, age in all capital and age in all small or mixed script are entirely different variables or functions or classes. That is, in general, these are all different identifiers. Here, an example is name. Say small NAME or capital NAME. Or only the N in capital and rest in small are all different identifiers. Again, these identifiers can be variables, functions, or classes. A identifier, although a digit is allowed in the naming of an identifier, but the identifier name should not be starting with a digit. Cannot be starting with a digit. I should not be saying should not. Because in that case, it will be a syntax error. For example, first name or one st then name, this is an invalid identifier. The fourth rule is we cannot use the reserved words as identifiers. That is, we have discussed already some of the identifiers, some of the keywords very briefly. We already encountered at least mentioned the name of if, for, while. These are some of the keywords in Python or reserved words. This cannot be used as the name of an identifier. So let's write some brief code regarding to check what will happen if I do, I mean, if I kind of violate this naming convention. First, if I use something like this to name a variable. So first name, say Guppy. So if I execute this, you'll be seeing a syntax error. That means the syntax of this statement is wrong. Remember, syntax is basically the grammar of the Python language. Similar to the grammar of English language, syntax is the grammar of the Python language or any programming language. In our case, it is the Python. So this is a syntax error. Now let's look at another example. If I use one keyword to be used as an identifier, so if I make one variable as if, say, and put some value, say 1, 2, 3, one integer, again it will be syntax error. Because in Python, this is a syntactically, this is invalid because this is a reserved word and it has some previously defined or Python developer defined meaning, and we cannot redefine this. But if I change this if to say capital IF, this is perfectly fine. And now if I print, you can see 1, 2, 3 is getting printed. That is, all the Python programming syntax, all the syntax will be case sensitive. Capital IF, capital I, capital F, small I, small f, or small I, capital F, all are different. Let's look at another example. Let's define another variable, say name equals to Guppy, and name equals to say Bagha, name equals to say Alice, and name equals to say, oh sorry, Bob. So now all these four variables are basically different. Now if I execute it and if I just print the names or the different names that I have declared, you will be seeing a different values that are put inside these variables. Okay, moving ahead. We cannot use special symbols like exclamation mark, at the rate, hash, dollar, percentage, or hyphen in the variable name. Also, colon is another variable, another character that we cannot use inside to name a variable. Say, if I use something like first, then name, this is an invalid one. Say, ABC, M, this is an invalid one. You can see it is a syntax error. But again, I am repeating, this is again another invalid one, syntactical error. Hash cannot also be used because we will be discussing that hash is a character which is used to comment or document, as we have discussed in the fifth stage of a program development stage, the program development phase. Hash is a character to document a program, and these characters are not allowed to name one identifier. By identifier, I'm specifying variables, functions, and classes. For example, these are some of the invalid statements like first name, salary, underscore, in, underscore. Up to this, it is perfectly fine. But dollar cannot be there in the name of an identifier. Also, percentage mark. Another thing is, I again like to highlight here. Here, it is saying that an identifier will be named with lowercase letter, uppercase letter, digits, and underscore. And I have mentioned that it cannot be starting, should not be, I mean, it is invalid to be starting with a digit, like first name. But it can start with some lowercase letter, as we have seen here, some uppercase letter, as we have seen here. It can start with underscore as well. Like, I can name one variable like this. Name equals to say Haru. So this is perfectly okay. And also, if I want to print the name, it is perfectly fine. And an identifier name can be of any length. I mean, if I want to make one very big identifier, like this is a valid, so I'm just copying that one to save some time. So here what I have written in this then is a valid but long variable name. And if I put some name here, say Charlie, it is perfectly fine. But there is a catch. Not actually catch, there is a warning or there is a suggestion that the programmers are given. That is, this is basically a bad identifier name. An identifier name should be something to indicate what type of data it is storing in case it is a variable, or if the identifier is a function, the identifier name should be specifying what type of work the function is doing, or in case the identifier is a class, the name of the identifier should be an indication of what type of data and what type of function the class is actually containing. I am repeating, this is a valid one, this is a valid identifier name, but it is advised that we should not be using this kind of identifier name. A good practice in declaring identifier is we should be using something that is meaningful. For example, if I am counting the number of students who have passed in an exam, I can declare one variable using the term, naming the variable as, say, var, V-A-R, to indicate variable. But var is a very generic one, right? We should be using something meaningful. So that's why count, or say pass count, would be a much more indicative of what the data, what the variable is actually containing. And also, if there are multiple words that should be encountering in the identifier name, there are two ways to make multi-word identifier. One is using underscore in between, say mean underscore average, or capitalize the second word onwards, like student name with N as capital. So these are some good practices in declaring identifier names. Any question up to this? Please respond. I'm online, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so I hope there is no question. Please feel free to interrupt me at any point. Now, today's discussion will be on literals. As we have discussed, the different components of a Python program are these. We have already discussed keywords. We have already discussed about identifiers, focusing on variables. We'll be discussing functions and classes details in later classes or later lectures. Today's discussion will be concentrating on literals. Now, literals are the data given to a variable or a constant. This was the same diagram that I have used earlier. Here, this is a box. Basically, this is the variable. This is another box, again another variable or container that is containing some value. Here, these values are formally named as literals. Now, here there are two things: a raw data given to number one, a variable, or number two, a constant. Now, we have already discussed that a variable is basically a named space or a memory location used to store a value. For example, Bob is the value that we are storing in this variable, although the name of the variable is not there. There is something, say name, or say here it is, say bull. Bull is the name of the class here, or type of the variable here, say B, although B is not a very good identifier name. The point is, these are different containers to contain the different values. The container names are the variable names, and the value that it is containing, it is storing, is formally named as literals. Now, these are variables. Also, a constant is a type of variable, a special type of variable whose value cannot be changed. Now, having said that, I would also like to inform that a constant is basically a convention. We'll be discussing at the latter part of today's lecture what is a constant, but it is not actually, I mean, true that a variable cannot be renamed. It is not renamed, but cannot be changed. It is not actually true. We'll be discussing that. For the time being, let's stick to the let's assume that a constant is just a special type of variable. That's it. Or we can just, for the time being, we can consider just the variable. So basically, literals are the raw data given to a variable. Okay. Now there are five types of literals that are present in Python. Numerical literals, Boolean literals, string literal, special literal, and collection literals. Now, if you notice my words, I have used numeric literals, a plural. That means there are multiple types of numeric literals. Now, how to check what type of literal one variable is storing? Can someone guess how to check? We have discussed this earlier. There is a function.
Type function.
Correct. To check the type, we can use this type function. For example, type, say, Bob. So you can see string. Type of, say, 1, 2, 3. You can see the type is int. So here 1, 2, 3 is a literal. Earlier this Bob is a literal. And if I specify, say, some set 2.34, this is the float type of literal. And this is basically the actual literal or the raw data. This is the raw data given to a variable. Now note that in the definition I have mentioned that a raw data given to a variable. Or a constant. Now here, this raw data is not stored anywhere. It is also a valid one. So basically here, I am not storing this raw data or formally this literal somewhere in the memory. It is just the existence of this 2.34 is just in this cell. If we want to reuse this, as we have mentioned earlier, we need to declare some literal. Say 2.34, and then we can type, and of course print the type. Also, we can print the, we can, I mean, using this, using this variable, we can retain this value. Now, if I print A, we'll be getting that same value again. But the point is, a raw data can be present as it is, or without being stored in some variable. Although it is given in the definition, but it is a convention or to make a program, as you can assume or as you can guess, that it is better to store it somewhere so that we can use that for later usage. So the numeric literals, there are basically three types of numeric literals: integer, float, and complex. Now we have with our basic program, one or two line programs that we have written up to the last class, we have already encountered integer literals, such as here I am specifying, I am declaring one variable B and storing the value 29 in that variable B. So here 29 is an integer literal. Now an integer literal can be declared or can be set using either the corresponding binary representation, that is binary representation of the actual decimal value, the decimal representation itself, the octal representation, and the hexadecimal representation. Now the binary representation is basically a representation consisting of only two digits, 0 and 1. Here, 29 is the decimal value. The corresponding binary representation is 11101. So how to convert this 29 to this binary representation? For the time being, you can just, briefly I can mention that if you just divide this 29 by 2 and then if you take the remainder and the quotient and keep on adding, I mean keep on concatenating the remainders, the remainders, correct, we will be getting this binary representation of the corresponding decimal value. Now there is a catch, we need to consider them from downwards to up. So we can have a separate discussion on how to convert a decimal number to its corresponding binary representation. Similarly, noctal representation is a representation that use the 8 digits from 0 to 7 to represent any number. So basically 0 will be 0, 1 will be 1, up to 7, that is decimal 7 will be octal 7 as well. But the decimal 8, as there is no 8, the digit 8 is not present in this octal representation, 8 will be represented as 10. So basically 0, 1, 2, up to 7, then 10, 11, 12, up to 17, then 20, 21, 22, up to 27, and so on. Again, we can discuss this later, although this is not actually the focus of this course, but we can discuss this later. Another representation is hexadecimal representation, which is of base 16. Earlier, the base of binary was 2, base of octal was 8, 2 because there are 2 digits, 8 because there are 8 digits. Hexadecimal representation has a base of 16. That is, it is consisting of, the representation will be consisting of 16 digits or 16 characters, you can say. The 0 to 9, the different digits, all these mathematical digits from 0 to 9, along with A to F, the 6 alphabets, the first 6 alphabets in English. So together with this, the 16 characters will be used to represent a value in its corresponding hexadecimal representation. Now here, all these representations such as this, this is the binary representation of 29, this is the octal representation of 29, that is 35, and this is the hexadecimal representation of 29, that is 1D. If I specify only 11101, it will be considered as decimal value. So that is, if I just copy this thing, if I just write it like this, 11101, it is basically, if I print the value, it will be printing the value 11101. So by default, if you use any digits to represent one in numerical literal, it will be considered as decimal. To specify that the representation is a binary type, we should be preceding the representation with 0b. Now, if I put 0b before this, and now if I print this, it will be printing 29. Now, I am not actually printing it. So it is basically, you can see it is printing 29. So the thing is, all literals will be converted to decimal while printing. Similarly, if I declare say C equals to say 35 and print C, it will be printing as 35. Now if I want to specify that this is the octal representation of this is the octal representation, what I should be doing is, I should be preceding this representation with 0 and then small o. Now if I print this, you can see the corresponding decimal is getting printed. Similarly, for hexadecimal, it is 0x. Now if I just change this o to x, it will be, so basically 0x, so basically 35 is the hexadecimal representation of the decimal value 53. So we can have a separate discussion on how to convert a decimal value into its corresponding binary representation or octal or hexadecimal representation, but that is not actually the focus of this course. Briefly, we'll be discussing this later. Okay. Now, if I declare this, I mean, if I check this, so this is A represented in binary representation. This is C represented in hexadecimal representation. Now, if I print the type, we'll be seeing that it is int. And also, if I print the type of C, we'll be seeing that it is again int. So the point is, whatever representation we are using, whether it is binary or hexadecimal or octal or the simple decimal one, all of them will be basically of type integer. So the mother type is int. So these are the way we can declare an integer literal. That's why I am specifying type A double equals to type B, double equals to type C, double equals to type D. Any question on this?
Sir, why there is a zero before B and X?
Good question. So this is basically the convention. So this zero is actually specifying that this will be something, I mean the following thing will be a representation not by the default, binary or octal or hexadecimal. Now you can see, if I declare a D, say 1, 2, 3, so this is by default, it is decimal, right? Now if I just precede this with B, it will be a name error. To specify that this will be a binary representation, we should be preceding a corresponding value with 0 and then the corresponding thing, either B, O or X. B for binary, O for octal, X for hexadecimal. Otherwise, if we do not specify this O 0, it will be a name error, because in that case it will be, I mean, the interpreter will be unable to understand what this is actually. This is not actually an integer. This is not actually a string. So that's why it is I should not be saying it is a convention, but this is a rule again imposed by the Python program developer, that whenever we will be using other representation, we should be using this way of doing, I mean, this way of declaring the variables. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Okay, so the second numeric literal is float. Again, we have seen this. So these are some of the variables: float 1, 10.5, float 2. This is another way of declaring one float variable. 1.5 e2. So this is basically 1.5 into 10 to the power 2. This is the exponential representation, or sorry, exponential declaration of a floating variable. Say float underscore 2, or any say f equal to say 1.5 and then e then 2, and then if I print the value of f, we'll be seeing it is basically 10 square, so it is not equal to 10.5, it is basically 150. So again, like integer variable declaration, integer literal declaration, this is another way of declaring one float value. So by default, this is 10.5 float. 1.5 or any value followed by e2 will be considered as exponential 2, basically 10 to the power 2. Of course, if I change it to say something 3, it will be basically 1.5 into 10 to the power 3. Now again, similar to the integer thing that we have discussed, the type of float 1 and float 2 here will be same. Both of them will be float. Is there any question in this? I'm expecting one question, one doubt. One thing that I haven't discussed yet, but which is given here.
Sir, okay. 1.5 into E2 actually is an integer, 1500.
Right. No, actually it is getting printed. Yeah, basically this is 150. It is basically, it will be printed as 150.0 like this. So if I print the type, it will be float, but although it is 150, but as the representation is a float representation, this is basically a float declaration, not representation. Float declaration, it will be of type float. That's why 150.0.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So the thing that you should be asking me is, what is this double equals to doing here? Single equals to are used to assign some literal or some value to a variable, as we have seen. This double equals to is a basically a special type of operator that is used to check the equality of two values. So I was expecting this question because it was here also. So it is basically a syntax. Again, some syntax defined by the program developer, the language developer. In this case, the Python language developer. This will be used in so many programs that we'll be encountering in this course, and we'll be discussing this in details in next lecture tomorrow. So now this is the same code to check the to get the value of to get the square root of a number. I'm just copying the value, copying the code to show you something. Now here, notice that there is this colon. That's why this colon has some specific meaning. That's what I was mentioning about the different naming convention of a variable. Now, as we have seen, so if I declare x equals to say 123, and if I print the value of g here, g is supposed to be printing the square root of x. Now you can see it is printing, I think, 15 digits after decimal value. Now what if you want to print up to say 4 places, or say 5 places, or 6 places? So there are certain ways of doing that. I'll be discussing 3 ways of doing that. First way is using one percentage sign. This is called a formatted output. So if I want to print the value of g here up to 3 places of decimal, I would be printing this using this statement. So instead of printing g, what I will be doing is I'll be putting them in a quote. As you can see, it is in quote. In quote, I'll be putting percentage mark, then point, then say 5. If I want to print 5 places after decimal, then f, and then percent g. Now you can see it is printing the value up to 5 places. Now note that if I print the value of g here, it was 09053. Now it is basically rounded off up to the 5 places, 54. Another way is using an inbuilt function in Python called format. So this is the way of doing that. If you try this code, you'll be getting the same output up to say 3 places. Another function is round, which takes 2 arguments. First the number, and the second argument is the up to the decimal place up to which you want to actually round it off. So you can try this at your end. So these are some of the ways to set the precision of the floating value. Now the third literal is complex literal. The complex literal, as we know, consists of a real part and an imaginary part. For example, this is a valid complex literal. Basically, this is the complex literal 2 plus 3.14j, and this complex literal is assigned or is put inside this variable. Now let's write this code here. Let's quickly copy it to save some time. Now this is the complex literal, and this is the corresponding variable which is storing this complex literal. Now what I am doing is I am printing the value of x, and I am printing the corresponding imaginary part as well as real part of this x. Also, I am printing, let's print the type of x. You can see, okay, so let's put another thing. I hope by now you understand what this means. So this separator, earlier the separator was space, that's why x image and x real was getting printed with a space in between. Now I have put it with new line character, that's why they are getting printed in different lines. So the value of x is basically whatever we have assigned it with. X image, the imaginary part of x is 3.14 here, and the real part is 2.0. Now note that I have mentioned 2. Basically, whatever we will be specifying, it will be considered as float value, even though it is given as an integer value. So this will be same, and the type of x is complex. Now while declaring this complex literal, you can see that I have mentioned one j here. Now if I do not mention this j, this statement will be invalid, because in this case it will be considered as a floating literal, which is basically evaluated. So 2 plus 3.14. So if I just print the value of x here for this, and if I just comment this out, that is remove this, you can see the value is getting 5.14. Ignore this for the time being. We'll be discussing why I am getting this later on. Notice that it is basically getting evaluated or getting summed or summed up in between. So that's why this j is specified here. Again, this is a way that the Python programmer developer had been imposed, or to impose this, I mean they have imposed this or to or defined this to specify one complex literal. Now we have seen it's complex. Now type of x real and x imaginary, basically this already we have seen, will be float, because the type that was getting printed, although it is integer, as we have seen, the x dot real's type was float, and the image part also, so there of type float. So the type of the individual component, that is image part and the real part, the imaginary part and the real part, will be automatically converted into floating value or floating literals. Now notice that I am interchangeably referring to a literal as value. So basically I'll be doing that. Basically, as we have mentioned, literals are the raw values that are assigned to variables in the definition that I have mentioned. So that's why sometime I'll be referring to literals as values. Now there are certain ways to initialize one complex literal. One is using this complex class. So there are certain conditions. So if I use this complex one, it will be, I mean, if, so basically this is a function, you can say, although formally it is basically a constructor. This constructor, I'll be discussing what is constructor later on. For the time being, let's consider this is a function which is taking one parameter. As you already understood, I guess, that anything that is followed by one bracket, first bracket starting, first bracket ending, is basically a function. So this is again some kind of a function which is taking one parameter. So this parameter, so the condition to initialize one complex literal using this complex function is if the first parameter, in this case there is only one parameter, is a string. As you can see, it is a string. It will be interpreted as complex number, and the function must be called without a second parameter. So in this case, it will be considered as the real part, and the imaginary part will be considered as zero. So if I quickly check that complex, say in quote say 2, and if I will put this, and if I print the value of x, you can see it is basically considered as 2 plus 0j, or the real part is considered as 2 and the imaginary part is basically considered as 0. Okay. Also, if there are, I mean, again, this is containing only one parameter. In that case, in this case, it will be basically typecasting. As we have mentioned earlier, if we want to take one integer from a string as input, if I just put say 2 plus 3j, it will be converted as, there is one thing here. There should not be any space. This is one restriction. Notice that there are certain, if I put space here, it is not a problem. It is not an issue. As you can see, this is getting, basically it is getting printed. But the syntax is, we should not be putting any space here inside this complex function as the first parameter. In this case, the x is basically as it is basically typecasted into a complex number. And if I put say two parameters, if I put say two parameter like this, it will be an error, because if the first parameter is string, then the second parameter, there should not be any second parameter. So in this case, this is a error, which is another type of error called type error. We'll be discussing in detail what type of error, what these types actually specify later on. Okay. Another condition is second parameter can never be a string. Like if I specify 2, 5, it is perfectly fine. The second parameter is considered, the first parameter will be considered as x real, as you can see 2. And the second parameter will be considered as x image or imaginary part of x. But in this kind of notation, the second parameter cannot be a string. This is one restriction. Also, another thing is the first parameter can also be a complex number like this. In this case, you can see this is the image, the first part, and this is the second part. The second part is basically considered as 0 plus 5j. The first part is 2 plus 5j and 0 plus 5j together. This it is resulting into 2 plus 10j. Okay. Another condition is each argument may be of numeric, may be any of numeric type, like we have discussed. It can be 2, 3, it can be some floating value, it can be integer, it can be, like this we have seen. The second parameter, let's see what it would happen. The second parameter as complex, it is of course fine. The result, you can imagine, you can compute at your end why I am getting minus 4 plus 5j. Let's look at some example regarding that as well here. So now if I specify complex 1 plus 3 plus 4j, what will be the result? Let's 3 plus 4j, what will be the result? Anyone? So the second part will be considered as the jth part. So basically j will be basically multiplied. So j square is basically minus 1, as you can, as you know, regarding complex numbers. So it is basically minus 4, and this is basically 3j, right? So the result will be minus 3, because minus 4 plus 1 minus 3, and this 3j is basically the j multiplied into this 3. So if I do this, minus 3 plus 3j. Now please answer this. What will be the result of this? What is the complex number that I will be ending up with? Anyone?
Minus 4 plus 6j.
Minus 4 plus 6j. Why?
Because
j will be multiplied. Yeah, go ahead. Follow.
And because the second part will be multiplied by j, and 4j square means minus
4.
And
right.
3j, and first part is 3j, so 6j.
Minus 4 plus 6j, correct. Similarly, this part, you can say that it, I mean, easily say that it will be minus 4 plus 3j, because 4 will be multiplied, this will be minus 4, and 3j will be 3j. Minus 4 plus 3j. Minus 4 plus 6j, and of course, if I remove this, minus 4 plus 3j. Perfect. And if the imaginary part is omitted, as we have seen, the imaginary part is considered as 0. And if I just mention, say, y equals to another variable, complex, just complex, without any parameter, it will be, and if I print the value of y, it will be 0 plus 0j. It will be again, it will not be, it will be of type complex. Okay. Now the second type of literal after numeric literal is called Boolean literal. So Boolean literal can have either a true value or a false value. Now, I hope you can recall that this true and false are some of the keywords or reserved words, those were defined by the Python developer. So they have basically some specified meaning. Basically, true specifies, roughly specifies one, basically some true values, and false specifies zero, some false values. Here in this statement, let's again copy this. Oops, this cannot be copied. Okay. So basically, x equals to 1 equals to true. So now this statement is basically checking whether 1 is true or not. And if it is true, then it will be resulting into a true value. And the value will be stored in x. So now again, as I briefly mentioned, equals to is used for equality checking. And by A equals to B, we are checking whether the value stored in A, value, which is actually also literal as well. That is, the value stored in A is equal to value stored in B or not. Now, if I just briefly write one code, say if I declare, say, A equals to, say, 5, B equals to, say, 5. Now, if I print A equals to B. A equals to B. Is it true? Anyone? This equals to will check whether the value stored in A is same as value stored in B or not. Is it true? Value stored in A, correct. So this is true. So that's why this will be resulting in into a value, or resulting in into a literal, formally saying, which will be true. Now, if I change it to say something other than 5, it will be false. So this true and this false, and of course, these values can also be stored in a variable. So C equals to this. So if I print C here, it will be basically false, as you can see. And if I change it to 5, it will be true. Now the type of C will be basically of type bool, j specifying the boolean literal. We will be using this equals to and all these boolean literals more in next class, while when we'll be writing these codes with conditional statements. Now, literals, as we have mentioned, raw data given to a variable or a constant. Here, constant is a type of variable whose value cannot be changed. Again, a container, from the definition of variable, a container that value that holds some information which cannot be changed later. But I also like to mention that in reality, this is not actually true. We can actually change the value stored in some variable, in specifically this kind of constants. This is one code. Let's skip this for the time being. What I am doing here is I am making one constant.py file. I am storing these two values, and then I am importing that constant.py file from my main program, and I am printing the value. Let's skip this, but for the time being, let's remember that constant are basically a convention. It is a convention that we should be declaring, we should be naming the constant with all capital letters, and they cannot be changed. But again, I am highlighting that it does not actually prevent reassignment. We can actually change the value of pi. If I declare pi equals to 3.14159265 something or the other, and if I print the value of pi, we'll be getting the value. Later I can change the value as well. Say I can change the value to say ln. In that case, pi will be having an entirely different value, which is not even a number. Again, this is just a convention. So let's keep this thing for the time being. We'll be discussing this later when we will be discussing modules. Okay, so today we discussed about numerical literals and Boolean literals. Tomorrow we'll be starting with the other literals, and later on, after concluding that, we'll be starting with the conditional statements and different type of statements in Python. Okay, any questions?